So on YouTube, I have a playlist about self-hypnosis, and I've been recently putting some videos there where I work on my journal. This is one of those journal videos. Although, unlike the previous videos, I will likely speed this video up because it creates an interesting dynamics where I can speak slowly, where I have time to think, to ponder, to be creative, to be relaxed. Arnold Schwarzenegger, in one of his inspirational videos, said that everything good is happening when we are relaxed. And he has a point, because when we are relaxed, it means our parasympathetic neural system is activated. So our body creates energy, and we can use this energy as we go on. So it's a sustainable process, and it's also a creative process, because when we are relaxed, when our parasympathetic network is activated, when we have extra time and feel safe, it means we can experiment, we can be creative. On the other hand, if we are in a hurry, if we need to speak fast, then it also correlates with the risk. Usually when we have to react fast, it is in a critical situation which is associated with the risk. When it comes to risk, our body might prefer to use the trusted, old, battle-tested, tested with time methods. So it is less creative. When we are in a hurry, we are less creative because we don't need this luxury of being able to experiment, to go back if something fails. Because if we are in a hurry, then we need a solution that's going to work, because we cannot go back. Right? If we fail, it will be a delay. We cannot go back. But if we are not in a hurry, if we are relaxed, if we have this extra time, which goes with parasympathetic activation, then it means we can experiment, we can go back and do something again if it fails. So it allows for creativity. And on the other hand, when this video is being fast-forwarded, when it is played in twice the speed, then we are in the heart of someone who watches this video. We need to invest less time into watching it. So again, we can be relaxed watching this video, because we know that we are using the time efficiently. So it's a win-win situation. When we are the heart of someone who makes this video, we can be relaxed. And when we are the time of someone who watches, when we are the head of someone who watches this video, we can be relaxed as well. So speak about the wonders of modern technology. This fast forward allows for some interesting balances around the videos. So I'm going to work on my journal a bit. It is interesting to capture thoughts as they emerge. Sometimes when I make a video, when I work on a journal and I'm making a video, it goes in unexpected directions. Sometimes I just feel that on video I can capture something that I cannot capture in text just as well. And there is this CIA document released in 2003, document from 1983, which mentions the gateway process and then compared to hypnosis. So I'm going to post this into a playlist about self-hypnosis. So it might be interesting. They compare it to hypnosis. And to transcendental meditation, to Kundalini, to working with Kundalini, and with biofeedback. And it was 1983, but they were actively working with biofeedback. Today, we have these biofeedback devices on the market. Back in 1983, I'm sure they didn't have these biofeedback devices on the market, but they were experimenting in a lab, and they were using biofeedback to improve meditation. So they compare these things, hypnosis, Kundalini, biofeedback, with the gateway process. And gateway process, as far as I can tell, is basically, at least in the form that is available today, it is a set of audio sessions, prepared in the Monroe Institute. And these sessions, and I'm a hypnotherapist, I study hypnosis and the science of hypnosis a lot. And in my opinion, these sessions it's basically hypnosis sessions. Hypnosis sessions, it's classical hypnosis techniques, right? But with the added utilization, the other tool of sound therapy. So they're using the sound and the binaural rhythms in particular. But I would argue that if you take a raw hypnosis and the hemisync of Monroe, which uses binaural rhythms, and I assume that binaural rhythms work well, then we have something somewhere in the middle, hypnosis with sound therapy. And by sound therapy, I mean something like a frequency generator, which is available for mobile phones. So you can install frequency generator and listen to the sounds on certain frequency. Listen for 40 hertz, for example, right? And there are some scientific evidence that sound therapy works, that it positively affects the brain, and people remain more healthy for a longer time when they use sound therapy. So it's not necessarily binaural rhythms. We can simply listen for 40 hertz, and it will still work. It will still have a positive effect, and it will also have an effect on attention, and it will also help the brain to boost some more. So we can use, for example, like if of course we have a good enough device which can give us that frequency. My headphones can actually give us 7 hertz frequency. So but I tested some other headphones and they were just 7 on the frequency. So we can simply use hypnosis and sound therapy together, and it might be somewhere in the middle between raw hypnosis and hemisync of Monroe. Right. So it is an interesting combination already, and the gateway experience is this set of hypnosis audios, which are combined with binaural sound therapy. But my point actually is that I started to listen to some of them and I looked at advanced focus just now. And in this advanced focus, they suggest to visualize a protective sphere, a kind of an energy sphere around us, around the listener, a sphere that protects us and that can contain our energy, can kind of boost it. There is an interesting theory behind it, which is mentioned in the CIA document, an interesting theory about frequency synchronization between a person and some natural rhythms, right? This sphere, in this hypothesis of the sphere, kind of helps with this synchronization of the rhythms. Regardless, what I have noticed is that this suggestion to make a protective sphere, it's actually a very popular concept, I think, I'd say spiritual practices that involve visualization. So if you have visualization of some kind, then it's kind of a logical idea to imagine this shield, and it might relate to fantasy, where in fantasy we have this image of a wizard in a shield, also in science fiction. So here we see some folks in a shield, a guy in a shield. So this is kind of neat, no? When I've been visiting some hypnosis courses, I was a hard, inconvenient student because I practice the self-hypnosis a lot, and a typical hypnotist would assume that I would simply follow suggestions, but there is actually a study that mentions that when people learn self-hypnosis, paradoxically, their suggestibility falls down. They are less susceptible to suggestion because they know how to use suggestion on themselves, so they need not this external force that would guide them. So a person who has mastered self-hypnosis to some degree, they are not a very convenient subject of hypnosis, because there is a contention because the person hypnotized is also a hypnotist, self-hypnotist. So there is a contention between this external guidance and guidance that the person can offer themselves. So here, when Monroe in gateway experience was suggesting me to visualize this shield, this energy sphere that would protect me, I had a bit of an objection. In places I modify this experience, I offer edited suggestions. So Monroe suggests one thing and I instead override it with something else. This is what I wanted to capture, that instead of visualizing this protective shield, I rather visualized a force of a magic surrounding me everywhere. Like, you know, in Star Wars, where Yoda says to young Skywalker that the force is between all living things. It is everywhere. So I thought, why would I need energy sphere protecting me and separating me from something that is outside of it, if all the magic, all the force is essentially my energy field? So instead of visualizing some private energy field, I visualize the magic itself, the force itself that connects everything. And I visualize particularly the friendly, the protective force. It is a kind of a spell of protection, a visualization of protection. But instead of visualizing my private sphere of protection, I visualize that it is the magic itself that protects me. So here I scribbled this down. And here's the Yoda quote. Now, when I did this, I felt a need to feel grateful. And this is another popular technique, a popular spiritual and psychological practice to feel grateful. But there are interesting idiosyncrasies and verbal terminological hiccups around it. So this is another thing that I wanted to highlight. Because I think there is a problem with how the term grateful is framed around society. So in society, to feel grateful is often to be indebted. And indeed, Cialdini in Persuasion speaks of this of these moments when people feel indebted to us and how we can exploit these moments, how we can find and exploit them. So in the society, gratefulness is a sign of weakness, right? Gratefulness, weakness, because then we feel indebted. But I think that the etymology here is actually full of greatness. Grateful is a full of greatness. And in Christian aesthetics, there was this concept that felt strange to me when I encountered it at first. It felt rather strange that the highest, a kind of a highest achievement, a highest mark of success from the point of view of some of the Christian aesthetics is to partake of the greatness of God, of the glory of God. So glory is, which is strange again, because socially we are afraid of vainglory. So glory has this negative connotation, because socially it is polluted, it is contaminated. And gratefulness is contaminated with debt, and glory is contaminated with vainglory. So, but in Christian aesthetics, there was this concept that the highest we can strive for is to feel this glory of God. And I think gratefulness is this feeling of glory, is that we have found something, that we have found something cool. And this glory, this greatness, is what entails gratefulness. So it's like you know, gospel. The meaning of gospel is sharing good news, and this gratefulness is also it's like resonating the glory of what we have found, resonating it out, like resonating. If we think about this field that we feel, the field that is not a sphere, not some isolated sphere, but rather a field of the magic that is behind the universe, and we are resonating the glory with this field. It is if we think about religion, then this is definitely a religious experience. We don't have to think about it in religious terms, perhaps. It's an option. And to offer some alternative, maybe, to religious interpretation, in Fractal AI, we have this concept of an agent. So a swarm intelligence in Fractal AI, swarm intelligence, consists of a multitude of agents. And these agents explore different aspects of space or of a solution space. They explore kind of stochastically, but also like semi-stochastically. They explore and they share their findings in this swarm mesh, so to speak. And this feeling of glory is like a feeling of finding something useful, something valuable in the context of this swarm intelligence. And the gratefulness, it indeed connects us with the rest of this intelligence, but not in this polluted way of indebtedness, but rather in a way that we are participating in some process, we are performing some function, some interesting function, and gratefulness is a feeling of this value, of being a part of something interesting happening. So again, I scribbled this down. Gratefulness as a feeling of participating in some interesting process, touching on the information entropy of the system, and information entropy, interestingly, information entropy is related to freedom and to the formula of intelligence. offered by Alex Visnagros.